Today's beer is the Quick Fix from Bookstore Brewing. They describe it as a coffee cream ale. This is another brewing company that I haven't heard of before, so, as usual, I figured I'd give it a try. So today I'm going to do a bit more tinkering with the Raspberry Pi Pico that I got in this starter kit a few weeks ago. I'm going to start from one of their lessons and then veer off in my own direction. I think I'm going to play with the servo, and there's a couple of lessons in the documentation that's linked from the sale page that have the servo, but then I'm going to try a few other things as well. So I'm going to need that. I'm going to need the Pi Pico. I think I'm going to use a bigger breadboard, one of the ones I've already got, and I'm going to need, I think I need that, and I'm going to need a bunch of wires, which I'll grab as I need them.
So servo motors are fairly cool little devices. You can control them just with a single data pin and low current connection, and they will rotate to a specific degree that you specify. That data connection isn't technically a data connection. What it is PWM. And if you vary the duty cycle of the PWM, that will cause it to move through its rotation. The one limitation is that you've only got 180 degrees of rotation from most common servos. But for a lot of applications, that can be more than enough for what you want, because you can control the angle of it very precisely. So as I mentioned, they've got a couple of projects, and they use a servo library to abstract most of the coding so that it's not that complex for somebody, which is excellent for a beginner project. And there's their basic code to get the servo to just swing through its 180 degrees and then go back again. I am going to use the more advanced one, though, that uses the joystick, which, as we discussed in an earlier video, is basically just two potentiometers and a push button arranged in a specific mechanical arrangement. So I am going to go and throw this together on the breadboard. They suggest connecting the servo motor's power supply to 3.3 volts. It'll work on 5 volts as well, but just to get started, I'm going to do it on 3.3 as they suggest.
So one thing I've discovered about connecting stuff up to this Pi Pico is the labels are all printed on the bottom side of the board. So find any website that's got a good picture of it, including the Raspberry Pi website themselves, and just print this out so that you can find where all the pins are. That's not power, that's ground. There are lots of grounds scattered all around the thing, so that's easy. The power pins are up in the corner here. The 3.3 out is pin 36, which is where I've got the servo motor connected. I just picked one of many grounds. And VSys is the 5 volts. So I'll plug that up there. That's pin 39, and that should do it. And also, just so it's easier to see, I'm going to put one of these servo horns on there. Normally, if you were going to connect this to a linkage or something, you'd put one of these on, and there's several different types come in the package, and that would allow you to connect a linkage up to it just to drive whatever. So now then, if we give it power, come on, stay standing. That's annoying. Just the twisted wires are kind of holding that. So if we do this, then we can control it. So two directions allow you to just go right to the ends. You just tap it and it goes right to the ends. The other direction, there we go, you can move it somewhat, and by clicking it sends it back to its midpoint. So that's what that piece of code does, which is fairly cool. But one thing that I learned in reading about this board is it can have up to 16 PWM outputs, and they can be assigned to any pin. And that means to me that we can use up to 16 servos. So I am going to try and add another one from my collection. Because, you know, I've got a bunch. I don't know whether I got 16 or not, but that should be enough to play with anyway.
So to accomplish this, I've just added a couple of things to their demo code. I've changed it. They were just calling it S before, so I've changed it to be S1 for the first one that was already in the code. And I've copied that and added an S2. So I've got a servo 1 and a servo 2. And this definition tells it which pin to use. So servo 0, or the first servo, servo 1, is on pin 0. And servo 2, the second one, is on pin 1. And then down here is the other reference. Again, I've changed the original one to S1 and added an S2. And this basically just sets the angle based on the reading the input value, which it calculates down here from various things, based on where the potentiometers are and stuff. So that's simple enough. It makes the library calls. It does everything else in their code exactly the same. That's the only two things that I've had to change. So let's load that onto the board and see what happens.
So there we go. Both servos hooked up. Let's see now. This one to GPIO 0 and this one to GPIO 1. And they should both respond to the joystick doing the same thing. Push the button to recenter them. So that makes sense. And we should be able to just keep on going like that, modifying the code and adding servos to it. But that's not the only way. The library does make it convenient, but you can do it without the library just by directly talking to the PWM. Well, let me show you.
So here's some code that I found on the internet on a few different places. I'll put a link to at least one of them down below. This one is not using the servo library. It is using the PWM function directly. So we are defining a PWM device as PWM the type on pin 1. We're telling it that the PWM frequency is 50 hertz, which is the frequency that these servos tend to expect. You can use others, but this is kind of what they're designed around, so we'll go with that. And then this little function down here is setting a range. So basically it is changing the position variable between 1,000 and 9,000 in 50 steps, in 50 unit steps. And what the 1,000 and 9,000 is microseconds of duty cycle. There's a bunch of math, and again, it's on the page that I linked to, but essentially that is setting the duty cycle between what the servos need for 0 degrees and 180 degrees, and it's just stepping it in 50 microsecond steps. Then it just sets the duty cycle of the PWM in a six, as a 16-bit value. Don't ask me to explain that. Again, it's on the webpage. I'm going to link, and puts that position into there. Then it sleeps for, you know, 0.1 of a minute and does that little bit of loop, this bit here, over and over and over until it gets up to 9,000. Then it drops down into this one and does the same thing exactly, only it starts at 9,000 and counts down to 1,000 and then does that same PWM thing.
And as you can see with that code running, because it's only addressing one of the servos, it is just rotating through its motion back and forth, just like that simple little bit of code said. Now, I don't know if using the library or using it directly like this is easier one way or the other. That's up to you to decide, but there's a couple of different ways to do it.
But now comes the fun, or maybe silly part. I have modified that one to be a 16 servo version. So basically just duplicated everything. Yes, you could do a loop to create an array and all that stuff if you were a little bit more advanced programmer than me, but I think this is easier to see without obscuring stuff in loops. So I've just defined 16 of them onto the first 16 pins, from pin 1 up to pin 16. And then I've just duplicated this part as well for servo 1, servo 2, all the way up to servo 16.
And because these things are going to be drawing a fair amount of power, not on their data pins, but on the power rail, I'm going to disconnect the power from the Pico, and I'm going to use this little tick station power supply that I got a while back to generate a 5-volt bus up there, which I can link and power it, so I won't power it through the USB, and a 3.3 volt bus down here, which I can plug all the servos into. So allow me to just get busy doing that, and I'll get back to you in a while once I've got my mass of servos. I've got to, you know, get wires and stuff onto these and put servo horns on them so you can see them. I will come back in a few minutes and show you this monstrosity in all its glory. Behold the majesty of what I have created. I present to you the Raspberry Pi Pico controlling 16, 15 because I can't count and I don't have 16 servos. Yeah, controlling 15 servos. 1, 2, and yeah, they're crashing into each other. 4, 5, some of these are mechanically a little bit rough. 6, right, 7 over there. No, 8? Okay, what's wrong with 7? I'll have to figure that out. 9, 10, hello? There that guy goes. Okay, so some of them, like I said, are mechanically a bit rough. That guy goes. I don't know what happened over here. And then 16, if it existed, would go there. So some of them are a little bit mechanically compromised because these are the cheapest servos in the world, and that's what you get. But they are all doing their thing, except for number 16, of course, which I forgot that I couldn't count or didn't have that many. The important part is the Pi Pico can do it, and my janky software, which I'm sure almost everybody watching can tell me a better way to do it, or 6 or 7 better ways to do it, but whatever. The point is that this is an amazing little board that can control up to 16 servo motors simultaneously. Yes, I didn't write it so that they will all run simultaneously, but that will be fairly easy to change if I chose to. But for this demonstration, there you go. Well, I hope that was interesting, gave you some ideas, got your brain juices flowing. I had fun doing this, even though this spaghetti mess over here was less than fun, and it's going to be interesting to put it all back. All these wires, minus, you know, the servos, but all these jumper wires came from that same starter kit. So that's kind of cool that there's enough to make a fairly big project in there. Anyway, thanks for watching. Questions and comments, and I'm sure there will be comments down below. I will talk to you later.